fuck.
Time there's no rocket force. You're going to you're trying to configure a rocket force on the back of this acquisition of the Pralay missiles, but Pralay alone doesn't make the rocket force. A rocket force would consist of other vectors also. You know, you have the Pinakas, you have the Brahmos, you have the Smerch. All these three put together, in fact all four put together, is what will make the rocket force. See, they are the same missiles. I mean, Pinaka is an existing system. The Brahmos is an existing system. The Smerch is an existing system. You're adding only Pralay to it, and maybe more will come in future. It is only that all these put together and with a command and control setup become a rocket force, right? And the Pralay is only 120 missiles. It will be maybe one or two units at best. It's a very small capability. But the fact is that you have enough in your kitty to start a rocket force. The force composition at this point of time is not much important. The force composition will become important as we go ahead. But the organization of the force and the capability of the force and what it wants, you want it to deliver from you, is more important. The point is this: you have a strategic force, but that's a nuclear force, right? You don't want to go always, you don't want the nuclear equation to come in. So you're going to have something which I call the non-contact conventional deterrence, right? And when you say it's non-contact conventional deterrence, it does two, three things to you. Against China, it gives you deterrent capability. Conventional deterrent capability. Against Pakistan, it gives you punitive deterrence capability, right? You can punish Pakistan. And the third thing is, in the Indian Ocean region, it gives you the ability to carry out power projection. So these three things to put together is what gives you non-contact conventional deterrence in as a whole. That's the importance of this rocket force, because so far we have not had this. So this gives you the leeway between conventional short-range artillery and the strategic forces to put things together, and you have a seamless system to do many things. It fills a gap. It fills a strategic gap. Yeah. Now the point is this. This is the most important thing. What will be the command chain? Now, if your strategic, your force is just to add on to capability, you don't need a separate force. You know, this is like artillery, another arm will come in, whether it's in the Army, Navy or the Air Force, that's a thing. And that cannot function by itself. It has to be part of a theaterization plan. So the theaterization and this have to go hand in hand. So the command and control, this won't do on its own. Okay. Or it could be, say, if you deploy some of these rockets in this capability in Andaman Nicobar, it has to be part of that command. So So ultimately, you have to evolve a system as to how you want to employ these rockets. You will have a force, but how to employ it is a different story. Yeah, it will deter China to a large extent, because what happens is, when you have a deterrence, when you have a range of, say, about 500 kilometers, and you can reach up to 500 kilometers, then the entire lines of communication of China are under your range. Once that happens, you know, for China to carry out any any offensive design is at a cost. It's a huge cost. And then you have the ability to carry out simultaneous action against the Chinese in the front and in the depth. You can make the whole battle non-linear. So that is important, right? To that extent, this force will be a great deterrent and of great value against China. But more important, I think you have to look at it beyond China, because the moment you deploy these on the Andaman Nicobar Islands, you get control of the Malacca Strait. Okay, that's power projection. That means you have a maritime capability in this. And against Pakistan, virtually, say, 500 kilometers of pralay, you can cross Pakistan into Afghanistan. So you have the capability of being punitive against Pakistan. So you have to, if you see it against in the larger setup, you have a greater capability. I think we are already well into rebalancing. We have already sent BrahMos up. We already sent the Smerch rockets up. We already put Pinakas up. Right? So it's only a matter of calling it a rocket force. It's only a matter of reorganization. And whatever comes in further will have to go up there depending on what your overall plans are. So to that extent, everything is fine. See, Prithvi is just a weapon system. When you have a force, you put together the integrative or the synergy of various weapon systems. For example, the Pinaka, today the normal Pinaka has about 47 kilometers of range, 40 kilometers of range. The guided Pinaka has a range of about 80 to 90 kilometers. And tomorrow, with technology infusion, if you can use a ramjet ramjet propulsion, you can get a range of up to 250 kilometers. And then you can use a scramjet on it. That means with the same weapon system, you're having four different capabilities. And that is the significance, right? You have different capabilities from the same platform. Now, that is also superimposed by the fact that you have a BrahMos, which is a cruise missile, and also Pralay, which is a semi-cruise missile and with a longer range. So all this give you various capabilities to address the battlefield from the front line to well into his depth. Oh no, there's no difference because they are already deployed. So whatever destabilization has to happen has happened. In any case, China has deployed all these on the other side. China has deployed its rocket forces on the other side, and they have actually publicized it. And they have not only publicized it, they have also carried out firing there. So whatever you are going to do, you are going to do only as a counter. So to that extent, there is no destabilization. If you say it escalation, yes, it is escalation, but it's not destabilization. Maybe this escalation will lead to stabilization. Deterrence leads to stabilization. Yeah, that's the very reason why this rocket force is being, shown as a conventional force. Okay, the fact that you are going to have a conventional deterrence and you're going to publicize it as conventional deterrence will, make it apart from the, nuclear vectors. So that's the differentiation. But actually speaking, once you fire a weapon system, you don't know whether it's a nuclear warhead or not. So that's a risk which one exists in all kinds of scenarios. See, when you come to this class of missile systems, you have to put something called recce, surveillance and intelligence complex into play. Okay, you need to acquire targets. Okay, you need to, home on to targets. So that whole system has to come in. Just getting a vector in is not a big deal. Just getting a new weapon system in is not a big deal. You need to look at the recce, surveillance and intelligence acquisition. You need to look at communication and networking. You need to look at the logistics. You need physical observation. I mean, I'll put it this way. You need multiple ways of observing the target and, handling it. To that extent, you need, space-based observation. You need aerial-based observation. That aerial-based could be by fixed-wing aircraft or by drones. And you need to even insert special forces, or you need to get observation in a hybrid mode. So all these things have to be fixed together and then networked. Okay. And then probably you have to intelligentize the battlefield. I'm using the Chinese term here. When you say intelligentize the battlefield, you got to use AI and ML into this whole construct. Okay, unless you use AI and ML put them all together, this will not function optimally. And it's a good way, it gives you a good start, clean start on using AI in the battlefield. Right? And I think it's a thing, but just by getting a vector in is of no use. You need to put the complete system in. The next thing which is very important is, what is the new technology you're going to get in to enhance the system? Because the systems which you have are already there with you. There's nothing new. How are you going to make the system powerful is the more important thing. For that, you need precision guidance. And you need to develop precision technologies and you need to develop them in-house. If you go abroad and buy these technologies, they're going to be so costly that your rocket force will not have the adequate numbers. So you have to make your own technology. You also have to have multiple kinds of warheads. You need to have latest propulsion systems to take. For example, if you are looking at a Pinaka system to have a multiple, role, that is a normal conventional role of 40 kilometers near battlefield. You go to 80 kilometers, you go to the intermediate battlefield. Unless you have 250 kilometers, you can't go into the depth battlefield. Okay. Now, all these systems, or you have a scramjet which can beat all air defense with the high velocity. So you need different technologies from the same platform. There's no point putting in more platforms. So the focus has to be on getting new technologies and enhancing the capability of existing platforms. So that's something which we have to look at. And precision guidance is something which we have to look at. You have to look at target designation, right? You have to look at terminal guidance very seriously. So all these things are there when you look at the rocket force to be optimally effective. Okay, you need to have a proper roadmap to reach there. And then of course, all this, how will it fit into your concept of battle? And how will it mesh with your theatrization is the important thing. Otherwise, you're not getting payoffs. See, you don't retire nuclear warheads. They are there. Okay, you can upgrade them. And you can't do it for the simple reason because China is itself upgrading its nuclear capability. They're going in for new silos. They're putting in a whole lot of capabilities. If they're going to do that, and if you can't retire, you can stabilize and you can cap your nuclear program to the number of warheads you have. But you definitely cannot retire these things, right? So I don't think we can do that. The short range ones, which we have to have, we must have. It's a different thing if you want to convert the short range ones with long range systems. That is, you upgrade the short range ones also with different propulsion systems to convert them into a dual capability of long range, then you're in a different ball game. I think you need to use the technologies and develop these technologies along with guys like IIT and ISRO. I'll give you an example. This is a personal example, and we are spearheading this project in IIT Madras. We are using ramjet propulsion, a new technology which we are developing it to retrofit it into this Pinaka system, which will give you 250 kilometers of range, right? And we are also developing for the first time precision guidance capability within the country. Now, these things have to be vectored. This entire program has to be on a mission mode and a more encompassing mode beyond DRDO. Because DRDO, I think, has come to its limit where it can deliver, right? Even this Pralay missile is short on technologies. It is exploiting existing technologies. Are they putting in new technologies? I don't think so.